It is time for me to do a kit build. It's a power supply kit, but it's not the same power supply kit you've seen people racing to finish. This is a little bit more old school one than even that one. This one is a transistor based linear rectifier power supply, and I'll show you what it's all about in a minute. This is Juice of the Oats Oatmeal Stout from Oxus Brewing here in Winnipeg. And that's a fine head on that one. I should have had that one in my last mailbag instead of what I did. So this power supply kit here, let's dump them out and see what we've got. Four of the same resistors, one big honking capacitor. Power transistor, this is the guy that's going to be doing all the work. And there's two smaller transistors that'll be kind of telling him what to do. A couple of plugs, a little diode, and four heavier diodes, which are probably going to be like a bridge rectifier. A couple of smaller capacitors and medium-sized one. So you know that there's going to be a lot of heat being dissipated by this transistor, partly because it's a TO220 package, and partly because it comes with a heatsink. Oh, and even a screw for the heatsink. Ah, the heatsink's tapped. Cool. Let's go online and see if we can find some information about this guy before we get stuck into the build. So this isn't the listing that I bought it from. This is just a random one that I found that happens to have a good description down below. But if you search for, you know, that kind of a set of keywords, you'll find it. So, input voltage, AC, 12 to 17 volts, no direction. Yeah, that's what AC means. You could also put DC in if you choose, because of course it's going to go through the bridge rectifier, so that's not a big deal. Output voltage, 8 to 14 volts. So, there's 4-ish volt drop through the circuit, best case scenario. Current handling 500 milliamps, which is a little surprising for that fairly beefy transistor, but okay. And here is the schematic. So, bridge rectifier over here. Nice, obvious, full-wave bridge rectifier. Smoothing capacitor. 1K resistor with a 10 microfarad capacitor to ground just to help stabilize things, I guess. Maybe to stop this from changing too fast. Anyway, another 1K resistor. So that's kind of voltage dividery. That goes to the base of this guy. So those two 1K resistors will be pulling it up. Current limited on the emitter side through that 47K resistor down to ground. But also coming off here, we have the unmarked of this guy. I'm going to say that's probably the collector going to there, and we got the potentiometer on the base forming a bit of a voltage divider between the output voltage and 1K above ground. We'd put the emitter with that 6.8 volt zener in its path, so this will never get above 6.8, and that actually, that and these two resistors here act as a bit of a voltage divider. So as this guy gets turned on more from this adjustable base current here, all three of these transistors are actually going to be operating in their linear range. They're not going to act as switching transistors, so they're all going to be dissipating some heat, but they've got some resistors in their collector emitter path to limit the current, so they're not going to get too smoky hot. Anyway, as this guy turns on, this voltage is going to go up, tamed down ever so slightly by this. That'll turn this guy on a little bit more or less, and we'll adjust the output, basically it'll change the voltage that appears here, which will influence how on this larger transistor is, and that's in series with the voltage, so it will be dissipating whatever the difference is between the input voltage and the output voltage across itself into the heatsink. And
Yeah, so that's basically how it works, or how it's supposed to work. We'll see if it actually does.
So, gather some materials. We need some solder. I've got a printout of the schematic here just in case I need it. But I'll keep that off to the side because it swamps the camera out. What else am I going to need? Cutters. And since I don't like soldering on my mat here, and, well, should I try doing it in the pan of ice? Yeah, maybe that'll get it up closer to my face and closer to you too, so you can see it better too. I think that's what I shall do. Got a fairly smallish tip, not the smallest one that I've got, but for a through-hole board, I think that'll be good enough. Okay, that's all the preliminaries out of the way. Let's get busy. I think the first thing I should do, I'll start right at the beginning of the circuit with the rectifier diodes. There are four of them in the classic bridge rectifier configuration. Like that. And I think I will also put in some resistors too. What did that web page say? There are 5 1K resistors and 1 47K resistor. So the 47K resistor goes right there. Get in there, you. I'm going to put all these small components, or most of them anyway, in before I flip it over to solder it. Just for speed and convenience. So there's one of the 1K resistors. They're spread out all over the board here. As usual, I'm starting with a combination of the shortest components and the components that are the least likely to get damaged by excess heat from me soldering everything else around them on the board. It's sort of a bit of a toss-up as to which is the more important thing, your convenience or not damaging things. Oh, there's one. Oh, that's the pot. Okay. So where does the 5th 1K resistor go? 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, I got a spare. Okay. Cool. Just kind of kink these over a little bit on this side so they don't fall out while I'm soldering. And slip that guy into there, and away we go. One downside of putting so many components in is that it gets a little bit busy to try and get your soldering iron in. But that's also an interesting challenge. You notice me pull my soldering iron out of the way every once in a while to clean it off. You'll hear the hissing of the sponge, which all these modern guys seem to be annoyed about. But it's what old timers have done forever. And our soldering irons aren't cracking and exploding like the naysayers say they should. It's probably not the absolutely best thing to do, but it's worked for a very, very long time. And it's cheaper than those fancy brass wool things. And I shouldn't get down on those things. I've got one, I use it occasionally, but after all these years, I'm just used to using the sponge. Okay, and now give him a haircut. I missed one. That's the other downside of doing a whole bunch of them at once. Sometimes you miss one. Right. So all the resistors. The only other... Oops. Let me just heat that guy and push him back through there. The risk of doing that is you, on a cheaper board, you might bugger up the pad. I'm hoping I haven't done that. This seems to be a fairly solid board. Yeah, that worked. Okay, let's throw in the Zener diode, 6.8 volt Zener. Goes down there. This board's nicely marked with the bands in on the ends, so that shouldn't be a big deal. Get those all in the right spot. Let's put in the variable resistor while we're in the neighborhood. That's got some bends in it already, so it just drops in there. Zener diode. Potentiometer. See, there's the four, the pins getting in the way. I was just pushing my solder out of the way with the pin of that diode. Okay, now I'm not going to trim the pins in the pot, partly because they don't need it and partly because they're heavier steel and they'll bugger up my cutters. What next? Oh, we'll put in these 10 microfarad caps. Is that what you are? Yes. Negative goes that way. Where's his friend here? Negative goes that way. Come on, get in. Right, both negatives are facing that way. Good. Bend them up. Actually, where does this 470 go in? I think I'll put him in after the transistors go in. And put the input and output plugs on, at least. And those will need some blue tack to hold them in place while I'm working on them. Just again, so they don't drop out. That's a little bit big blob, but it'll do. And this isn't actually blue tack brand. This is cheap knockoff from the dollar store. Because for those of you who have been watching me for a while, you know that cheapest viable is usually the way I go. And why spend the extra cash if you don't have to? Sometimes it's important to actually spend the money for your high quality product. But in a lot of cases, especially just for hobby work, you can get away with something fairly basic and cheap. I'm sure other people have said it, but Adam Savage said it most recently that I've heard, is that if you're not sure if you're going to use a tool or not, if you're looking to buy a tool and you're not sure how much you're going to use it, just get a cheap one. And if you use it enough to break it, then get a good one. And if you don't use it that much, then you're not out that much money. All right, what's left? The big capacitors. Get those deblobified. I think the little transistors should go in next, and they're both the same. 9013, just common little NPN transistors. Just bend the leads a little bit on that guy, and same on this one. And again, their silk screen on the board has the flat spot marked, so I'm going to trust the kit people that they haven't completely screwed me up. Maybe I'll put the big power supply capacitor into. Negative goes that way, because it's not going to get in the way of me soldering that transistor on. Now, I'm going to want to be a little bit careful when I'm soldering those transistors. They're not that fragile, but they're the most likely to be affected by heat of anything that I've done so far in this board. So what I'm going to do is go on that one for a little while, then come over here for a little while, and come over here for a little while. Just sort of move the heat around so that nothing gets roasted for too long and it has a chance to cool in between assaults. That may be overly cautious. That's just a habit born in my younger days when components were both much more expensive and much more hard to come by. Okay, it's a bit of flux residue on there, but that's not a big hairy deal. Let's throw this cap on. This is the output smoothing capacitor, the 470 microfarads. And again, I'm trusting the silk screen to show me which way to put it in. If the silk screen's lying to me on these capacitors, then there will be a kaboom. Hopefully not. Okay, so I think I will pre-assemble that. That's probably out of focus down there, but I won't stay down there very long. Because the heatsink has the hole threaded, you can just go like that. And I'm not going to put some goop on the back of this. This isn't going to be a constant used circuit. I'm not too stressed about it. Go bend that guy over that way a little bit just to hold it. And this is going to be the hardest things to solder because they're the biggest and they're going to dissipate the most heat. But even that wasn't all that bad. You notice it is taking a bit longer to transfer the heat onto it. Okay, and now the anchor pins on the heat sink. Because the heat sink's designed to haul heat away. Oh, that's not too bad. I was expecting it to be a lot harder. Ta-da! All things done. One part left over. Okay, I'm going to clear all the debris off the bench and we'll try and power it up. One moment, please. All right. There's our little board. Here is a source of AC. And that's not going to fit into those little terminals there. Damn it. Okay. So, got the AC coming in this side. Actually, let's just get this figured out here. Yes, this is a little scary looking. It's the high voltage side is relatively protected up there with 100-year-old tape. So what do we have on the AC input here? We have 9.3 volts. It's an 18 volt transformer coming off the center tap because this thing said that it can only handle up to 17 volts in, so I don't want to push it. So can I get those probes in there? No. Hang on. Okay, now there we've got voltage on the output side coming to this meter, and I've flipped it over into DC mode. Set that back out of the way. It looks scary. Nah, we're fine. Place your bets. Where's the... There it is. We have 10 and 11 volts out. Okay. Let's turn that one way. 7.6 is the minimum, which is the board said it could do 8 as a minimum. And 11. How is it, you're wondering, that we're getting 11.5 volts DC out, but the AC input, let me just see, that is only 9 volts AC. The reason is that this is measuring an average voltage, sort of an average, RMS voltage AC, not peak to peak on the sine wave. The bridge rectifier and that capacitor will be putting this output voltage here on this rail much closer to the actual peak-to-peak voltage, not the average voltage. So that's how come we're getting so much voltage on the output. There we go, not measuring any AC on the output now. And there's the DC, 10.07 volts. I don't think I want, should I try and push it? What's going to happen if I do? I don't know. Let me just resolder this onto, actually, no, I don't even have to resolder it. I'll just go across the two terminals. You'll see the DC voltage is slowly sinking down here as the capacitor charges. So I've got this set to max output right now, and I'm going to turn it down to about half. It's about there. And I'm just going to go on here, and I'm going to lean back a little bit. Nothing's exploding, so that is coming off the full 18 volts of that transformer, putting out about 10 volts. So let's turn this guy up, 12 13 14.6, and it promised us a maximum output of 14 volts. That's not getting hot because I don't have any real load on it. Those little guys aren't getting hot. Okay, that's not bad. Shall we put some load on it? 14.6 volts divided by 100 ohms equals 146 milliamps. This thing claimed to be able to do 500 milliamps. That should be good. So let's clamp this across the output. And I'm expecting this to draw it, to drag it down a little bit. There. That's not pulling that down that much. Here's my other meter here. Let's just put an ammeter in series. Yeah, so that's pretty close to what we calculated, isn't it? And it's drawn it down a little bit. But that's not unreasonable. I wonder if we've got another resistor in here. Another big resistor I can put on there. I do have another 100 ohm resistor, so I'll put that in parallel, which should half our resistance and double our current, so that should go up to about 270 thereabouts, and it drew this down, so we're about half a volt. Oh, even more. That's starting to get warm. Those little guys aren't really. Q3, which is this one, which is the one that's got, what is it? God, it's only got 2K and the Zener diode in series with it. So it's going to be pulling a little bit more current than this one, which has got 47K in its emitter line. But yeah, the big guy on the heatsink is starting to get warm because it's dropping. It's dropping a fair bit of voltage across it. Huh, can I measure how much voltage is dropping across there? Sure I can. Yeah, I should be able to measure the difference in voltage from the input to the output, shouldn't I? That should tell me. DC. No, I'll have to measure it from the top of the diodes to there. So there is 7.9 volts being dropped across from basically there to there, which is across the output of that. So it's, so 7.2 volts. So 7.2 multiplied by 0.27 of an amp equals almost 2 watts being dropped across, ow, that's getting hot, across that transistor. So that 270, 260 milliamps is about half what this thing is rated for. I don't think I'd want to run it at that for an extended period of time because it is getting toasty warm, but it'll do it without exploding. If I put some heatsink goop on, that might help a little bit. I don't know. If I was running it at a little bit lower voltage on the input side, closer to the output, well, I wanted to get 14 volts out of it just to see what it could do, because this is running right at its maximum. What is the AC voltage actually at this point right here? That says it is 18.62, so it really hasn't come down at all, which I guess makes sense because that's a 2-amp transformer, so we're not going to be drawing that down. Yeah, it works. It's fully old school, and I like that. Well, I hope you enjoyed that. That was fun for me, putting together a different kind of a little kit. Now, you may have seen a few other guys, a few other small YouTubers, doing a challenge to do a speed build on a slightly different power supply kit. And I've got one of those coming too. I'm not sure if I'm going to take them up on their speed build challenge or not. So it is Simple Electronics that have done it so far. And who else? Junk from Work has done it. And they've challenged some other people to do it. I'll put a link down in the description to their two videos where they put this challenge out. I've got the kit coming that matches the kit that they've got. If anybody else wants to jump in and play that kind of a silly game, go for it. I'm going to be doing it sometime in the next month or two when mine finally shows up. But I thought I'd just do a slightly different, more old school type of power supply. Thanks for watching. Comments, questions down below as usual. Talk to you later.